I'm Bjarne Stroustrup. I'm the designer and original implementer of C++.
Hey everyone, James Murphy here. This is a joint interview that I did with Tom from Context Free. We're interviewing Bjarne Stroustrup, creator of C++. I can tell that Bjarne deeply cares about the language and about the people who use it, so please enjoy his perspective. Once you finish this video, don't forget to check out Tom's channel, Context Free, where you can find the other half of the interview. Even back in, say, like 2014, you're already talking about things like concepts and modules and ranges, which are only now being implemented in C++ 20 and in 23. So my question is, for today, what are those things that you're thinking about for, you know, C++ 32?
Okay, 32 is probably a bit far in the future for me, but let me just point out one thing. I have to start talking to convince people that certain things are important. Even today, there's lots of people that don't quite see the step that concepts give to the use of templates. And similarly, today, I'm having a lot of trouble getting people to understand that coroutines really are not just cool and such, they're also important. And one of the things that I hope for C++ 23 is to get better standard library support for coroutines to make it easier to use them. Currently, they're sort of an expert level entity, and that's not what they're meant to do. It's very easy to write with coroutines. For the things where you really need a stream of data generated or pipelined, it's much easier to write coroutine code than it is to write it with you managing the state and saving it and restoring it. Again, it's a simplification. Apart from that, it runs faster. But people have to learn that, and they're not going to learn it till they get the support from the library that they deserve. Okay, then I end up talking about things for many years before it happens. And I can tell about what I'm thinking about now, but this is by definition half-baked. Please remember that.
Of course, of course.
I would very much like to see static reflection. That is, reflection is dynamic reflection is basically your code walks over a graph structure and does something. And you lose essentially all type checking. You lose the ability to understand the code because it's basically running a little interpreter in the background. And if there's bugs in what you're doing, well, there's bugs in what you're doing. It's not strongly typed. So I would like to get the effect of that without the runtime aspect, moving that kind of runtime stuff to compile time. So basically, I want to say, I have a program here, generate for me a JSON reader and writer for these three types. And there's been work going on about that. It seems have stopped a bit just now. We have to remember there's a pandemic going on, and it's hard to meet, it's hard to talk. The design of major features to support new ways of thinking and new ways of writing code is you need face to face, in my opinion.
Definitely.
I'm still dreaming of building these distributed systems. That's probably what when you say 36, that's probably where we're going with that. Maybe I can build the system I was trying to build back in 79, in a decade. Yeah. Let me just add one thing. Modules is one of the major features of C++ 20, and the standard library has not been modularized. This must happen so that it becomes easier to use. I mean, I have run things that compiles 7, 10, 50 times faster using modules. And again, you need some support in the build systems and some standards for it to get the benefits from that. And the other thing that we are going to see in the relatively near future, maybe not 23, but maybe 26, is a general model of concurrency, which again will build up towards the aim of dealing with more distributed things.
Now, of course, C++ is a very complicated language right now. You can do a lot of different paradigms, which is why I find the C++ core guidelines very fascinating. I find that it simplifies and focuses a view of the language. I'm curious how the community views that as a whole, and also what's the state of like automated verification of like compliance to C++ core guidelines?
The core guidelines came along because I realized that you cannot simplify the language. If you make a small incompatible change, you can annoy a couple of 100,000 people. So why don't we make a set of rules for what we think modern C++ is?
What about for people that are maybe more novice, they're just getting into C++, maybe they don't know C++ at all, but they're thinking of learning. How would you recommend for those people looking to get into C++ get started?
The way I think about it is there's at least two such groups. There's a large group of people who have programmed for a while, sometimes in C, sometimes in C++, sometimes in other languages, that wants to know sort of the fundamentals of C++. You can't put them through a standard textbook because it's boring, and they don't really need a chapter to be told how to write a for loop. This is my answer to that question, to of C++. I realized that you have to have something that you can read over a weekend and tell you what is in C++. People come in and they don't know that there's templates, for instance. Or they come in and they say, oh, you have concurrency support? Or there's a library for regular expressions? I've never heard of that stuff. This is what this one is for. Over the weekend on a transcontinental flight. That's the kind of book. Now, I also got a job some years ago as a professor to teach freshmen. And that's a different group. At the time, they either half didn't know anything about programming, and the other half weren't particularly good at it, even though some of them thought they were absolute geniuses. These are sort of natural freshmen, right? These days, more people have programmed before, but they haven't a clue why they're doing it or what they're doing it. They just want to build a game something like that, and not the quickest way of throwing things together. So I had to write, I had to make a course, and then I decided I had to write a textbook. So I've run many thousands of students through it. That's how I'm reasonably confident that it works. And other professors have done the same, so I'm reasonably confident it's not just me. And by the way, I did not put my books on the side because I was being interviewed. They're sitting the side of my desk because I keep getting questions about it where the answers are in the book. This is this thing here with swans on. And you don't do that over a weekend. This is meant for a student to be able to do in about 3 months taking a four course thing. And there's a third group that I care a lot about and I think a lot about, and I don't have a good solution. And those are the expert in other things that happens to want to use C++. That is a biologist that wants to be a biologist, doesn't want to be a C++ expert. Sometimes they use some scripting language or let's see, Python, JavaScript and such, and they can get something to run or MATLAB, and then they notice that it's running 50 times slower than it should, and they would like to get on board and do a little bit of tuning to get it to run somewhat faster. And I don't have a really good answer for how you help those, because the biologist thinks different from the physicists and so on. But if somebody has an idea, they should run with it.
So you talked about the committee. What is the process like of being on a committee meeting? What do you guys do? What do you talk about? How does it work?
The first thing to understand is that the standards committee is enormous. It is unbelievably large. Last meeting in Prague, when we voted out C++20, there was 250 people there. There are more people because not everybody turns up. So my guess is about 350 members. How on earth do you have a rational process with that many people without a management? I mean, the way you run a company with 350 employees is that you have rewards and you have penalties. These are two things we don't have and can't have in the standards committee. These are volunteers. These are enthusiasts. They are there to do good. Not everybody's idea of good is the same. So we have meetings in between the meetings, and there's a lot of email discussions. There's a lot of papers being written. These are the ones we discuss, and then it goes through a process before we vote. And the way the process works is we split up in many, many groups. The two evolution groups are discussing what should go into the language. And when they have decided and voted it should go in, they pass it over to groups that try to integrate the text with the standard text. We have the standards committee meeting where the technical people vote and agree to something. It is then given to the ISO that has the nations vote. And as this happens, the implementers work so we get better feedback. And by the time the final vote comes, the first compilers start coming out.
So when it comes to these kinds of interviews or ask me anything you do, is there any question you wish people would ask you but they haven't asked?
You know, that's a standard question that a lot of people ask me. I usually, for these very technical interviews, try and drift a little bit into sort of social issues. A lot of people are in a desperate hurry. They want to get their current job or their current ideas done immediately. And I'm saying, wait a minute, this is life. It's not a sprint. It's a long distance run. Make sure you don't burn out. Make sure you do other things than programming and system building sometimes. Take care of the family. Go see something. And also spend some time learning new stuff, foundational stuff, instead of getting more and more specialized. A lot of weaknesses I find the students is in communication. A lot of the best programmers are classical geeks, but it doesn't matter how smart you are if you can't communicate your ideas to others, then you could just as well do Sudoku or something. You have to get the ideas across somehow, and that involves communication. It means writing, it means speaking. There's people that are too busy to write tutorials, too busy to write comments, too busy to do anything but getting the code. And then they expect us to pick up the code and understand what it's for and why we should use it. No, you have to explain, you have to be careful, and you have to help your users. I was just reading something, forgotten who said it, but basically education is about what and why, and training is about how. I'm mostly interested in education, though of course I can't avoid telling people how sometimes.
Why did you choose, say, not to use simulator directly when you started C++ and so on?
I was a young researcher, arrived at Bell Labs, and I realized by looking at what people have